come into this place from the Arctic cold that has existed for the past week here that has chilled us to our bones. And we enter a place of warmth and of beauty. Know that here you are welcome. Know that here you are safe. Know that here you'll find strength for your weary spirits and food for your spiritual hunger. Know that here you are in the presence of God. Let us worship God. Let us pray.
God of grace, God of glory, through grace alone you entered into our troubled world. In Jesus, your glory shines in our midst. In Jesus, you come to us and you bring us to you. Gracious God, in Jesus Christ, you changed everything, and so we come to praise you. Your splendor shines from a manger where the light of the world was born to pierce the darkness. In the weak and fragile flesh, you are revealed to us face to face. And so we come, gathering together with all people in every place who have glimpsed your salvation and grace. We come to praise you, Creator, Son, and Spirit, source of life, glorious light, wisdom of the ages. We come to you knowing that you have already approached us. We bring our hopes and offerings. We bring too our limitations, our wounds, our shame, and our guilt. We pause to lay before you our pride, our fear, our doubt, our distraction. Forgive us, we pray. Come again to us, we pray. Holy Lord, your embrace gathers in all the lost and creates a safe home. Help us now to hear your good news for us again. Jesus Christ is our light and our salvation. In him truly we are made new. Let us then be at peace with ourselves and with one another. We ask, O Lord of grace, O God of glory, that you transform us more and more. Lift up our hearts in trusting you and help us to be seekers of justice, followers of truth, witnesses of redemption, and speakers of goodness in our still troubled world. And now, remembering Jesus, we pray again as he has taught us to do. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Good morning and a very warm welcome to you one and all on this cold New Year's Eve morning. It's good to have you worshiping together with us today. If by chance you have not been here before, we invite you to leave your name in our welcome book just beside the front doors. And if you are not here with us at all but are joining us online, we welcome you as well. A special welcome this morning to our friend known to us through many years, the Reverend Ian Fraser, who comes to us from Beaconsfield, Halifax, St. Columba, and joins us and leads us in worship today. Welcome, Ian. We are grateful to have you here among us today. You will notice that our bulletin is much thinner than it has been in recent weeks. There's hardly anything to announce, but there are a couple of things to draw your attention to. There's no church school today, as you may already know, but also we do have a youth retreat coming up on January 12th and 14th. I nearly said July, but that was just wishful thinking. If you know of a young person who would be interested, the theme is discovering your personal strengths, dependable strengths, and it promises to be a really worthwhile and intensive weekend, and I invite you to get in touch with Sharon Dvorak following the instructions in the bulletin. So this concludes our announcements. Let us continue to worship God.
The first lesson is from Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verse 1 to verse 15. Listen for God's word. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. What gain have the workers from their toil? I have seen the business that God has given to everyone to be busy with. He has made everything suitable for its time. Moreover, he has put a sense of past and future into their minds, yet they cannot find out what God has done from the beginning to the end. I know that there is nothing better for them than to be happy and enjoy themselves as long as they live. Moreover, it is God's gift that all should eat and drink and take pleasure in all their toil. I know that whatever God does endures forever. Nothing can be added to it, nor anything taken from it. God has done this so that all should stand in awe before him. That which is, already has been. That which is to be, already is. And God seeks out what has gone by. Amen. Here ends the first lesson. The second reading is from Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 to verse 7. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. And because you are children, God has sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but a child. And if a child, then also an heir through God. The word of God, thanks be to God. Let us worship God with our offerings.
prayers of thanksgiving, intercession, and commemoration. Let us pray. God of love, as we celebrate the birth and life of Jesus our Savior, we are filled with thanks. Our gratitude overflows in prayers for our world. Nurturing God, we pray for all children. Guard their minds, protect their bodies, strengthen their characters, and give them joy. Sustaining God, we pray for adults, parents, workers, people of every kind, old and young. Strengthen them and bless them and encourage them in their pursuits. Compassionate God, we pray for those whose hearts are filled with pain and fear, for those for whom Christmas is linked with loss or grief, for those who eat alone, without the comfort of human contact. Bless them with a strong sense of your presence. We pray for family members and friends who are struggling. Hear us now as we name in silence the concerns of our hearts. To all who are burdened, O faithful God, God of promise and fulfillment, to all these give your gift of peace. At the close of the year, draw us more closely to you that we may more and more be transformed, so that as we are sent into the world, we are faithful to you. Gather us into your care and keeping, along with all of those who have gone before us, that we might love and serve you and be your witnesses in this wide and troubled world. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray these things, and together we say, Amen.
Thank you.
nom du Père et du Fils et du Saint-Esprit, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Not long ago, I celebrated a birthday in the company of a friend when we discovered that we shared the same date. And he reminded me of something that I had forgotten. When I showed up at his house, I said, as I often do on birthdays, "How does it feel to be a year older?" And he responded, "Ian, we're not a year older, we're a day older than yesterday." So for those of you who are going to be out on the town tonight, reveling in an excuse to wear very silly hats, kiss strangers and drink too much, or whether you're going to be at home watching the ball drop at Times Square, feeling nostalgic for Dick Clark, when you shout Happy New Year and try to mumble your way through the words to Auld Lang Syne that I think only those from the Outer Hebrides actually understand, remember that the world is not a year older, but a day older. Birthdays, anniversaries, New Year's are convenient ways in which we mark time, as artificial as that is in many ways. But they permit us to look back and to evaluate and to know that in smaller or greater ways, we are different than we were a year ago, that the world is not the same place as it was a year ago. What took place in 2017? Well, it was a year with a new American president, one that did not bring a great deal of consolation or optimism to our world. Perhaps at least we can say that the world is still here a year later, something that some people doubted, and that we only have 3 more years to go. More locally, our nation and our city held year-long celebrations to mark 150 and 375 years respectively, with very different outcomes for the politicians who led them. A prime minister who still polls well in spite of new leaders being elected in 2 of the opposition parties, but a mayor who went down to defeat in large measure because of the extravagant ways in which he initiated projects. And what about your own year, 2017? What was it like? For some of you, I expect it brought sadness and grief and loss. Others, achievement and joy. And if we're honest, for all of us, it was a mixture of those things. The ancient Greeks had 2 words for time, which were very different. One word was chronos, from which we get chronology and chronological. It's calendar time. How successive days pass, one after another. The Greek god Chronos was depicted in much the same way as we do Father Time, as an old bent man with long white beard, carrying a scythe in one hand and an hourglass in the other, to remind us that chronological time flows in one direction only, that we are all aging and all of us will die. As the old hymn says so well, time, like an ever-rolling stream, bears all of us away. Chronological time is the way we normally and collectively count time. In minutes and hours and days and years. The other Greek word is kairos. And it's very different, and we have no English equivalent. Kairos refers to the right time, the right moment. One writer said, kairos is in between time, a moment of undetermined length in which something special happens. It's those moments when things seem to converge and we realize that we are living at the right time. Chronos is in time. Kairos lets us be out of time. Chronos is horizontal. It moves from a beginning towards an end. But kairos is very different. The kairos, the Greek god kairos, was a young man with wings, strong and vital, to remind us that kairos can happen at any time, at any age. And when it does, regardless of how old we are made new because it's opportunity. While chronos is horizontal, kairos is vertical time. It's when the divine and the holy intersect with our lives and our world, and something special truly happens. Ken Kamau, who's a Kenyan writer, wrote, God doesn't measure seasons with calendars, but through truth and revelation. And that's what kairos is. It's when we discover truth, when something that was hidden becomes revealed. Not surprisingly, Scripture is far more interested in kairos than in chronos. The book of Ecclesiastes is a brooding meditation on time, which begins with reminding us that there's nothing new under the sun, that what goes around comes around with startling repetitiveness. But it then says that God has set a right time for all things, birth and death, planting and harvesting, tearing down and building up, weeping and laughing, and so on, over which we have little or no control at all. Expressed negatively, it leads to a kind of fatalism. That if we have no control, as the writer says, we might as well just eat and drink and be merry. Because God will do what God will do, and God will choose to do it. But more positively, it leads us to a kind of humility and respect for the gift of God, which is time. When we live in a world that thinks it controls time and can squeeze everything it possibly can out of every nanosecond, when we find ourselves fretting because our smartphones don't keep us up to the second with our news feeds and social media, we need to be reminded that the things that matter most in this world, birth and death, weeping and laughter, planting and harvesting and so on, are out of our hands and in God's. The New Testament even more develops the concept of the right time. The Apostle Paul in Galatians said that it was at the right time that God sent the Son into the world in order that we might grasp the depth of God's love for us. He wrote that in Christ, we discovered a different basis for our relationship with God. No longer to understand that it was simply doing what we were told, keeping orders and commandments, but rather the new relationship that we saw in Christ was based on this intimate love, like parents' love for their children. A willingness to do anything, including giving up one's own life for a child's well-being. So no longer do we need to approach God formally in fear, but now can do so wholeheartedly in love. The whole New Testament testifies to somehow that being the right time for God to act. The birth narratives of Matthew and Luke that we have read through in recent weeks tells us that everything that had happened in the past, the patriarchs like Abraham, the kings like David, the prophets like Isaiah, and everything that was happening in the present, including the occupation by the Romans and the thirst for liberation that filled the Jews, made that the right time for God to send the Son. Now, right times are usually best perceived by looking in the rearview mirror rather than through the front windshield. It's often when we look back that we begin to see the signs and demarcations that led to a moment being the right moment, the Kairos moment. It was Malcolm Gladwell who introduced us to the term tipping point and argued that when big changes happen in our world, we often don't see them coming. But when we look back, we see all kinds of small incremental changes that made the big change inevitable. And that's how the New Testament writers saw the coming of Jesus. That all the prophecy of the past, as they read through them again, pointed to their fulfillment in him, that he was God's tipping point that all of human history had led up to. But I'm not sure that the people living in Jesus' time knew that. I'm not sure that they sensed that this was any kind of a right time. Yes, there were many who were expecting the coming of a Messiah, but that was true in many eras. That one no different. There was no sense that this was when all things would converge. And that reminds us that any time may be the right time. Any time may be the right time that God is preparing to act. Chronological time continues in a relentless pattern from beginning to end. We can't slow it down. We can't speed it up. All we can do is take down last year's calendars and put up the new ones. But Kairos time demands that we pay attention, to stay alert to what may be going on. One day early last fall, I was walking along a beach not far from Halifax, where I've spent the last year. And I stood and watched as the waves rolled in and crashed on the shore. Wave after wave after wave with monotonous repetition. Waves crashing in on that shore as they had done for millennia. And then I began to look at some surfers who were offshores away, straddling their surfboards, bobbing up and down. And what they were doing was waiting for the right wave, the big wave. And when they sensed that it had come, they began paddling like mad. And sometimes they'd guess wrong, and so quickly they'd cut out and head back to where they'd been bobbing before. But sometimes they get the right wave and they ride it all the way into shore. I would suggest that in 2018, we look for the Kairos wave. For the right moments when God is acting and turning us towards something new, towards opportunity. The Kairos moments when God is calling us to something different, something more, something special. I read recently a review of a memoir written by a woman named Shonda Rhimes, who apparently has been responsible for a number of popular TV shows like Grey's Anatomy. The book is called Year of Yes and describes how she accepted a challenge by her sister to spend a year saying yes to things that she normally would turn down, and how this opened her to a whole series of experiences only possible when she stepped outside of her comfort zone. I have a hunch that Kairos moments are much more contained in a willingness for us to say yes than to say no. Like the yes of Mary to the angel, like the yes of Joseph to a vision, like the yes of Magi to a star, like the yes of Peter and Andrew and James and John to an invitation to leave their nets and to follow, like the yes of Jesus to the cross and the yes of Mary Magdalene to the resurrection. It's when we have a willingness to leave behind our routines and our comfort zones, when we're willing to leave the sense of the horizontal time and open ourselves to vertical time, leave our misunderstanding that we're in control of time and recognize how God controls time differently. When we turn away from the old Chronos God towards the new Kairos God. When we stop marching in time and begin walking out of time, turn from no and towards yes, that we may find we're in the right time.
Thank you.
May the Lord bless you and keep you as you look for God's time to break into our time and prepare to say yes. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship and communion of the Holy Spirit rest upon each one of you on this day and forevermore. Together we say, Amen.